Happy Friday, Baylor College of Medicine and friends of Baylor College of Medicine. And I want to welcome some new friends. We have folks in Montreal, Canada that are following us. And a special shout out to Connor in UK. Connor raised the question about a dispersion constant. And I'm going to try and explain that later today because it's really important about how we understand how our epidemic is playing out in the United States. So first, unbelievable data on the vaccines. We just heard about the Moderna trial, 95% effective. The Pfizer trial has also finished, 95% effective. Very little complications. This is the best news. Janet, light at the end of the tunnel. But the tunnel still is long. That's the problem. We still have a long ways to go. But the good news is we are going to have effective vaccines. It looks like there's going to be early distribution to frontline healthcare workers. It's probably late December, early January. Then it'll go to people at risk, and then it'll get to the general public. So be thinking mid 2021, second quarter, end of second quarter 2021, we'll have enough vaccines in the population to actually begin to see some real benefits. So incredibly great news on that front. There are actually six vaccines that are in phase three, and it's not just the Moderna and Pfizer vaccines, the RNA vaccines. There are two adenoviral vaccines coming to fruition, and these will be the AstraZeneca and J&J vaccines. We should start hearing data about those towards the end of December and the early part of 2021. There are other vaccines in development, protein vaccines, killed virus vaccines. Peter Hotez's vaccine, we're very proud of Peter. His recombinant protein vaccine has been licensed to Biological E Limited in India. And with Dynavax, they're beginning clinical trials in India with the plans, if they're effective, to make a billion doses. Now, why is this important? I talked a little bit last week about the increasing developments of technology around nanoparticle vaccines. And so there's going to be continued improvements in vaccines. I already talked about the fact that the RNA vaccines are difficult to store and distribute. They require cold, ultra cold or regular cold. And so that's going to be a little harder to distribute to under-resourced places in rural communities and around the world. So protein-based vaccines are going to be much easier to distribute and store. And these will become online, and the rest of the countries, in particularly under-resourced countries, will have some relief. So incredibly fast movement. This is within a year to have a vaccine that's likely to be approved and effective is really kind of amazing. So nothing but good news on that front. I think, start thinking we might be behaving normally. Well, none of us behave normally, but as a country, we might be getting back to what we like to do in group and social settings towards the end of 2021. Now, there's some other good news. In some communities that adopt vaccines much more, readily, there will be communities that will reach herd immunity very quickly. So I would think middle of 2021, in cities that have a lot of vaccine adoption, they should be returning towards normal even in the third quarter of 2021. So lots of very positive news. Of course, there can never be all good news. There has to be some bad news. And the bad news is we continue to lead the world in cases. And we are in the middle of just a horrible spike. We're now over 11 million cases in the United States. And if you look at it, it's just unbelievable. Many of the other countries have been able to control their spike, but ours is just absolutely in logarithmic phase of growth. And it's interesting to see, if you look at the three phases, the early surge, the second surge, and now the third wave, or whatever you want to call it, but each one has been incredibly steep. And it's hard to, sort of explain that, but it's almost like the virus keeps finding places in the United States where people don't pay attention. And so it's logarithmic growth because there's nothing to inhibit. It's where people have not adopted mask wearing and they continue to gather and congregate. Those are the places that are driving the current epidemic in the U.S. And if you look at it, it remains the upper Midwest in particular. Georgia is also having a big outbreak, but mostly in the upper Midwest. Now, Texas, we're doing a little bit better. We're going up, but our rate of rise is slower. And we have some hot spots, but it's not all over the state of Texas. In Houston, we're rising, but the real places continue to be El Paso and along the Rio Grande Valley. Those are the hot spots, and those communities have not always adopted masking orders. You know, they have not closed bars, and they continue to congregate. So these are all things that lead to bad results with this virus. It's, the virus is the virus. It doesn't change. It's how we as humans are reacting to it, how we are managing the contagion of the virus. And by congregating, not wearing masks, we're making it easy for the virus to jump around and get into infect people. So the data in our 9-county catchment area, the Texas Medical Center, you know, it's like last week. It's inching up. We're above 1, so the virus is winning in our R value. Test positivity rate is above 5%. You know, compare that to New York, 3%. We're not doing as well as we should be. And our new cases are bouncing somewhere under 1,000, between 700 and 1,000 every day. You know, we wanted to get it to 200. So 700 to 1,000 is not good. And as you look at it, you can begin to see that our hospitalizations are inching up. For the last 3 weeks, they've been over 100, and now they're up to 147 as a 7-day average. That, you know, hospitalizations lag behind cases, so as you get infected, it takes a while. So if we have a lot of new cases, as we've been seeing in the last couple of weeks, we're going to have more hospitalizations. Inevitably, that will happen. And so we're prepared for that, but it's not great. So people have asked me, I don't understand why we get this high, you know, increase in infection, and other times it's sort of slow. What is driving it? And then Connor asked me, what is this dispersion number? What does that mean, and how does that impact what we do? Well, again, I have to apologize to the microbiologists of the world, but in the 1980s, there is a whole field that developed called population genetics, where they used continuous culture of bacteria in solution in medium to model infections in populations. And we are actually seeing exactly what those scientists in the 1980s showed. And basically, if you throw a bacteria into a flask, it's a, you know, just a regular flask with medium, this is what happens. It takes a while, it begins to think about growing, and then you get logarithmic growth. And that curve looks exactly like what's going on with us. Well, why is that? Well, the virus in that case is the bacteria, and guess who the medium is? We're the medium. So this virus is growing in us, and when it goes in an exponential phase, what that means is it's free reign. Just growing everybody, grow, no limits at all. But in the flask, what happens is it begins to peak and then it flattens out. Well, guess what that is? That's herd immunity. When you get to that level, there's no more medium. The bacteria is looking around for where do I go? Same thing happens with the virus. When we hit 60, 70% of everybody being resistant, either because they got the disease or they were vaccinated, there's no place for it to go. So it begins to plateau. And then eventually it begins to fall and go away. Well, that's when the R value is less than 1. So that actually describes a lot of what's going on. What is gets a little bit subtle is that slope. The slope of that line is based on the R numbers, or how infectious is the virus. So in measles, it's really fast. In SARS, it's kind of fast. And you can see that that slope is very much dependent upon the R value. Well, remember, our R value is about 3 in SARS-CoV-2. But because we do things to prevent it from jumping, we were masked, we socially distanced, the R not, or R3, the number 3, it's not 3. It's less than that. It's more like 1.5. We want it to be under 1 because then it's going away. At over 1, it's going between people. So that's where we can have a big impact. But again, just to get to the number, to understand what the R value of 3 means, if one person's infected, they infect 3. Those 3 infect 9. Those 9 go to 27, 81. That's logarithmic growth. And within a very short period of time, you have over 700 people infected. And so that's the kind of growth rate that you would expect and you would normally see. But what we're actually seeing is this in Texas. We're not going like this. This is what happened with the rest of the country. In Texas, we're doing this. So a lot of people ask me, why is that? Why aren't we going up like the rest of the country? Well, the fact of the matter is we're not, because we have people who've been infected and our community has adopted mask wearing more than most. And so because we have people wearing masks, the three isn't going to infect nine, the three infects five, and then the five infect eight, and eight infect 13. That's an R value of 1.6. And then at the end of six rounds of infection, we're, you know, like 30, 35 people, not 700 or 800 people. And that is the benefit of wearing masks. It's very, very important. Now we get to Connor's question, this dispersion thing. Well, there's two ways to get, if you have 10 people who are infected and they infect a number of people and it gets to the number of 16 because the R value is 1.6, there's two ways to get there. You can get there where one person infects two, it just goes pretty homogeneously distributed. That's the kind of thing we do in the bacterial culture. We're all homogeneous. And the policy around that would be, if everyone's just infecting everybody, you know, according to the average R value, you know, if it's two, one infects two, two infect four. If everyone's doing it that way, and that's what's going on in your community, then you would do things like keep schools shut, or you'd stop businesses, you'd lock things down, because you've got to apply this to everybody. The problem is we don't act like a homogeneous culture. We're actually different from that. And what we found, if looking at the data, is 80% of the people who are infected are not transmitting it to their colleagues. And why is that? It's because they wear masks, or they're around people who wear masks, or they're practicing physical distancing. So 20% of the people are responsible for almost all of the transmission. And those 20% are the folks that we produce super spreader events. So we still can get to 16 people infected with our original 10, but it's not because it's kind of averaging out. It's because they went to a bar and infected three. There was a wedding and they infected seven. And there was a birthday party, they infected five. That's still 16, and so when we do the number, the R number comes out 1.6, but the difference is it's through a number of these social events of super spreading events rather than the averaging out, everybody's behaving the same. So, and that difference is what is called the dispersion constant, or K. So what we really probably are seeing is that our number of 1.3, but you throw in the fact that we have these social gatherings and we're spreading it in super spreading events, it raises it up to 1.6, but we don't behave that way. Now, why is that important? Because when we think about how do we manage the pandemic, we don't need to close retail stores. We don't need to prevent people from going to school. What we need to do is not go into bars. We need to not have weddings where people aren't, you know, practicing social distancing. Birthday parties where multi-families get together. Thanksgiving coming up, big issue. You know, I couldn't believe my eyes, but last weekend I walked by one of the churches in my neighborhood and there was 25 bridesmaids standing in a cluster together, not a single one wearing a mask. So I was there before my eyes. I am witnessing a super spreader event. So, you know, that is what's driving our infection here in Texas and so and in the Houston community. And there's also a tremendous thing looking at the COVID use by state and versus mask use. And it, again, linear. I've shown this before, but there is a linear relationship between wearing masks. If you wear masks, there's a linear fall in the amount of virus and infection. So the reason I bring all this up, partly to answer the question about dispersion, but also to look at what do we need to do in the coming weeks. You know, we're all tired of wearing masks. We're all tired of not, you know, having our normal get-togethers, but that's what we have to do. We have to do that until we get a vaccine. There is no other option. But what we really need to do is pay attention to these multi-family clusters where people are not practicing physical distancing and mask wearing. So that brings us to Thanksgiving and Christmas holidays. I hate to be this way, but you know, you should not be having multi-family get-togethers. If you have family you're bringing together, your immediate family, then go through the bubble formation that Jim McDevitt referred to earlier, and we We'll give you the reference to that. We now call it McBubble because we named after Jim. But the idea is to be very rigorous, have a family understanding that this is what we're going to do, quarantine appropriately, test, and then quarantine again, and then you can get families together, the nuclear family together. But don't have multifamily or inter-household gatherings. It's too dangerous. Even if you do have friends over and you must have them over, outdoors, distant, masks when appropriate. But it's really, we have so much to lose in the next 6 weeks to 2 months by not practicing public health measures when we're just around the corner from having a solution. So please think about that as we go into the holidays. It's so, so important, and it's so critical to our being able to manage this the coronavirus pandemic. So have a great weekend. Holidays coming up. I will be giving you some answers to questions, commonly asked questions, next week. And we're going to do that right before the Thanksgiving holiday. So have a great weekend, and I will see you next week.